Welcome back. This lecture provides a quick overview of Section 702 of the FISA Amendments Act. By way of background, the key provisions I'm going to discuss were first enacted as Section 105B of FISA under the Protect America Act of 2007. Those provisions lapsed in 2008, then were reenacted under the FISA Amendments Act. So, if you see a reference to Section 105B, that's just the predecessor version. Okay, so here's the idea. The Section 702 Surveillance Authority applies when data is inside the United States and the person targeted for surveillance is both outside the United States and not a U.S. person. I've thrown an asterisk on the non-U.S. person requirement because it wasn't included in the original Section 105B, but it was added with the FISA Amendments Act. All right, so it turns out that the majority of data stored with American cloud services belongs to foreigners, and the majority of telecommunications traffic in the United States, other than streaming video and file sharing, is associated with a foreign user or business. That means Section 702 covers the majority of cloud data in the United States. And Section 702 also covers the majority of telecommunications traffic in the United States, including internet traffic and phone calls. This is an extremely broad surveillance authority. And you don't have to just take my word for it. Here's a slide from the NSA itself, emphasizing that international telecommunications traffic is very often routed through the United States. Now, let me explain the procedure under Section 702. I want to emphasize that this procedure is very unusual. It's not like any of the other surveillance procedures that we've looked at. Here's the idea. The Attorney General and the Director of National Intelligence submit a filing to the FISA court. That filing includes a certification that, among other things, a significant purpose of the surveillance will be foreign intelligence. Note just how broad that is. NSA analysts can invoke Section 702 authority for an exceedingly wide variety of purposes. They don't need probable cause or reasonable articulable suspicion or even relevance, nor does there have to be a foreign power or an agent of a foreign power. Again, all that's required is that foreign intelligence is a significant purpose. The filing also includes targeting procedures, explaining how the executive branch will make reasonably sure that surveillance targets are outside the United States. Oddly, the executive branch doesn't have to explain how it will avoid inadvertently targeting U.S. persons. The filing also has to include some minimization procedures. These aren't minimization of collection procedures, though. They're minimization of use and disclosure. They're very different from the minimization procedures that we've seen under the Wiretap Act. And critically, they allow for law enforcement use of collected information. All right, so that entire bundle of paperwork gets filed with the FISA court. A judge then thinks through whether the certification and procedures are statutorily sufficient. The judge can request changes, and that has happened. Once the judge is satisfied, they issue a Section 702 order. That's just one order, and it's good for an entire year. So the current practice is that just about the same filing gets submitted year after year, and judges keep approving it year after year. All right, so once the government has its Section 702 order for the year, it can then issue so-called Section 702 directives. These work a lot like warrants or wiretap orders, but there's no court involved. They get served on a company, and that company has to produce stored or prospective content. And, of course, it has to provide any ancillary assistance that's required. The company could be a telecom, for instance, handing over voice calls or voicemail. Or it could be an email service, handing over both saved and future messages. Or a social network, giving up messages and posts. or even an internet service provider handing over internet traffic. This is really, really broad authority. Section 702 covers all electronic communications and cloud services, and it covers both stored data and prospective communications. Roughly, a Section 702 directive is like a combined provider warrant and wiretap order. Broadly speaking, there are two types of directive that the Department of Justice has sought to issue under Section 702. The first type, which shouldn't come as too much of a surprise given what we've just covered, is a targeted directive. It's a demand served on a particular technology service for stored data or prospective data associated with particular accounts. The PRISM program, which we'll look at in the next part of the course, is an instance of targeted Section 702 directives. The second type of directive under Section 702 is a bulk surveillance directive. The program associated with these directives is usually termed upstream collection. Unfortunately, there remains very limited public information on the NSA's Section 702 upstream surveillance. I'll do my best to shed light on that subject, too, in the next part of the course. The final point I'd like to make about Section 702, for now, is that it's very controversial. One common criticism is that it just doesn't afford foreign individuals and businesses enough protection. Remember, the NSA analysts just need some intelligence purpose, and they're off to the races. And analysts don't have to demonstrate any factual basis to a judge. Many observers have framed the lack of protection as a human rights issue, and many others have framed it as a blow to America's technology sector. Another thrust of Section 702 criticism is that it involves massive incidental collection of data to, from, and about ordinary Americans. When the NSA conducts extensive surveillance of foreign individuals, businesses, and governments, it necessarily conducts extensive surveillance on Americans. As a formal legal matter, recall, the executive branch and the FISA court have taken the position that incidental collection is totally acceptable. Regardless of whether that view of the law is correct, as a policy matter, incidental collection has sparked a lot of concern. In particular, the notion that federal investigators could intentionally search through this incidental collection for data involving Americans, so-called backdoor searches, has been extraordinarily controversial. All right, so that's enough on Section 702 for now. In the next part of the course, we're going to look more closely at the PRISM and upstream programs. And in the next lecture, we're going to look at Executive Order 12333, an even broader set of surveillance authorities.